There. Secondly, we'd also like to thank our sponsors, Dell and NVIDIA. Without them, we wouldn't be able to give you this amazing live content. So we have other amazing live events, and of course, we have this evening's live event. We are honored to have KitBash3D co-founder and co-CEO Banks Boutté and art director Danar Worya share the history and application of the industry-leading asset library. So I'll be honest with you, when I actually came here and started working at Nomen, I didn't know a lot about assets and development and kind of how much the environment really played into the immersion of all of the things that I loved. And as you dive deeper and deeper into the creation of a lot of the stuff that I enjoy, one of the things that you realize is that the immersion isn't just the plot and the characters, it really is the world that you're surrounded in. And it's very exciting to learn about it, because for me, everything that goes into anything that I enjoy, you can always tell when you're talking and listening and hearing from these people that work on this stuff, that the story is always on the forefront of their mind. The why, the how, the when, all of that stuff. So I'm really, really excited to hear how it all started and everything about KitBash3D tonight, right now. So without further ado, let's get started. Everybody, help me welcome to the stage, Banks.
Thanks, Chris.
Yeah, I'll do that with you, man.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Chris and Nomen. Good to see you all. It is so exciting to be here again with you all. It has been 4 years since we were here at the end of 2019. We did the last talk of the decade. So 4 years feel like a good cycle of a graduation for us, and now back here because times have changed and it has been a really deeply exciting adventure to go on. A quick poll here just to make sure I understand who's in the room with us. How many of you all are students currently at Nomen? Great, so almost everyone. Is there anyone in here who is working in the industry? Were you a student at Nomen before?
Before? No.
Great, so excellent. So That is very helpful just so we can frame this, because I think there's a whole lot of things we can talk about here, and I think it's really important that we talk about the changing of this industry that you all are about to enter into. So we have a really fun show for you tonight. We've got Danar Worya here, who is an absolutely incredible artist, worked on things like Last of Us and Shazam, has got a bunch of new really cool projects with will.i.am and Kid Cudi and things like that that he's going to talk to us about. But I thought before we dive into the details, let's take a super wide lens at this industry that you all are part of and what's happening here and why what you're doing and what's happening in this industry is important. And so I thought we could start wide and zoom in and zoom in and zoom in till we get all the way into the details. So KitBash3D, I'm very pleased to be here representing and part of, and feel like it has been such an amazing process and teamwork to get to this space. And so what we talk about a lot at KitBash is the virtual frontier. And this idea, many people are like, what is the virtual frontier? And I can tell you what the virtual frontier is not. The virtual frontier is not a company. It is not a quarterly earnings report. It is not a piece of software or even a type of hardware. The virtual frontier is all of the underlying technology that will make the 3D internet possible. And if you think about where we are today, 3D is dominated. The conversation is about movies and video games. And that is where we live today, but it's how movies and video games participate in the rest of our lives that makes such a difference. If you think of fact here, 8 to 12 hours a day, we are spending in front of screens. And this next generation, 2 of every 3 kids in America are on Roblox or Minecraft or Fortnite, which is an astounding place to just level set as to what is happening here now. And this inevitability of the internet is very interesting to see where we're going to head. And media plays such a crucial role in that. And social media is a really interesting piece of how media participates in each one of our lives. And so just like this generation that I'm talking to now, just like you all grew up watching YouTube and vlogs and people on Twitch, this next generation grew up in a 3D space interacting. And so the virtual frontier is already realized in many ways. The internet, as most of us experience it for 8 to 12 hours a day, is 2D, right? You scroll up and down, you swipe left and right. That's an X and a Y. But tomorrow, the Z-axis is coming to all of this. And when we go forward into the screen, fundamentally, the fabric of human connectivity will shift. And that makes this such an incredibly exciting time to be alive. If this we can agree upon is an inevitability, then we have so much opportunity to be working in this industry. If you were in this room, or you were at this school, or you were watching this live stream, if you're part of this global 3D art community, you have an unbelievably unprecedented opportunity to have a disproportionately massive impact on where we go next as a society, as a people. The very fabric of our connectivity is based upon this. And if we can agree that that is an inevitability, then we can start to talk about the business. Right? The business today is movies and games. All across the halls of Noman, all across the up and down Main Street here of Hollywood, there is movies and games are driving the conversation of business. And that puts us in a really unique place to talk about a whole bunch of things. And you might be thinking blind enthusiasm. You might be saying, hey, this is actually a difficult time here in the movies and video games industry, in the world as a whole. And though that is, we can look at what is happening, right? We can say the industry is on strike, right? We can say that AI is here, and there's a lot of fear that AI is going to take our jobs before we even get into the space. There is the economy. You can look at the widest lens of this and say, hey, the economy is on the brink. And though some of that may be true, these are certainly unprecedented times, We don't have a crystal ball. We are not able to read the future. But you can take a look at the past. And there's an idea that history doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes. And we've been in this position a lot. And if you'll go with me here a little bit backwards in time to 2007, there were some very significant things going on. There was massively disruptive technology affecting how the business was going to work. That was the internet. That was Netflix. At this time, Netflix was sending you DVDs in the mail. They started streaming in 2008. Justin Bieber was a YouTuber before anyone on Earth had called anyone else a YouTuber. He was still just a YouTuber at this time. But this technology was so disruptive that this industry went on strike. And we had a global financial crisis that years later, they now call the Great Recession. It's 2007, 2008. If that doesn't sound very familiar to you, well, actually, I hope you see how it sounds quite familiar. And we're in a different place here to see what we can do, because from that type of change offers so much opportunity and so much disruption and so much unique opportunity for people here to find their position. I'll tell you how I began, because it was in 2007, and I was working my very first job out of school. I was just like you all. I was working right across the street at Paramount. And I was a PA on a show called Nip Tuck. And my job was to stand outside the door, and when the red light was on, they were rolling on the other side of the door, and I told people they couldn't walk in the room. Literally a lock could have disrupted and wiped out my job. And I was like, I came to Hollywood to make movies. I want to be in the room when it happens. And so I started thinking about, well, what is all this? How do people break in? And I heard of a USC student who was making really big waves at Sundance. And I was online trying to find a way to watch the Sundance short. And at the same time, a friend of mine emailed me a link to a YouTube video. It's like, I shot this yesterday, what do you think? Not gonna win Sundance, but it's interesting, and I saw it. And what I wanted to do, of course, I wanted to participate and be in the conversation, but I also just wanted to connect. I wanted people to see my work, and I wanted to be able to find a community that I could continue to work with and develop over time. And the internet offered that in a way that was completely disruptive to the time and space. And so I had this idea. I thought, I'll make a web series. You know, remember, Netflix is mailing DVDs at this point. But I figured it out, I went online, found out you could sell it on iTunes, and we'll go after a niche market, and we'll shoot the thing on this crazy thing called a red camera, because digital cameras were now absolutely disrupting the local industry. And I got one of the producers from Nip Tuck to go to lunch with me. And we went to the famous Mexican restaurant across the street, and there's all the pictures of everyone who ever made it in black and white in Hollywood. And sat there and I pitched him the whole thing. And I was 19 years old and going 100 miles an hour, and he sat there just listening to everything I said. And I was like, this is going awesome. And I pitched him the whole way through, and at the end he goes, what the are you talking about? And he's like, what is a web series? And how are you gonna shoot something for $50,000? And he got really upset. And he was like, make a feature. Just make a feature and put it into a film festival. It's what everyone does. And I was quite impressionable and was like, you're right. This was too ambitious. I'm above my know-how here. I should figure this out. So I got into a class at UCLA called The Business of the Film Industry. And the first night of class, I'll never forget it. I was in a big auditorium, and the teacher walks up and says, I've been working in distribution at Warner Brothers and at Fox and at CBS for my entire career. I'm going to tell you exactly how we make and distribute movies. And then she said, but that's the old way. Technology is going to come in and change this. The internet is going to disrupt what we are doing. And you people are gonna figure it out. I'm gonna give you a history lesson, and you people will take that. And the next day, the writer's strike happened, which got me really deeply thinking. Because Kevin Kelly, the editor of Wired, talked about all business at the turn of this last century. And he said the model was have a business, add the internet, have a new business. And that was pretty indicative of what was happening here in Hollywood. Not only that, but the red camera came along, and then the subsequent digital camera revolution of the 5Ds and Arri Alexas, and all of a sudden for the price of developing the film, you could purchase the camera outright and shoot as much as you wanted on it. Changed how we did everything. Made visual effects a whole lot cheaper. Made making production a whole lot cheaper. It brought the barrier down, made a lot of opportunity. Also made a lot more content, so you had to find your way in. And then we had mobile phones. And everyone got a phone in their pocket. And then all of a sudden, we were able to have cheaper distribution. And then Hollywood took that and said, we need to change the way we do business. We need to make visual effect tentpole movies, but we need to do it on a cheaper budget. Let's get visual effects artists to direct our movies. And you got people like Joseph Kaczynski, or Gareth Edwards, or Wes Ball, and they made big studio projects. And then you had people like Neil Blomkamp, made a $30 million movie called District 9 in 2009. Blew everyone's mind of what you could do with such a small budget, and things changed. And that offered opportunity for those who were willing to look for it. That offered great opportunity for those who were looking for something new, for a way in. And that's what the movie studios were doing. But then everyone got a movie studio in their pocket with your phone. You could then shoot high quality video, you could edit it if you wanted it, and you could distribute it. Massively disruptive. Oh my Lord. This is going to change how we do everything. And not only did it change how Hollywood did everything, it changed how everything works. 8 to 12 hours a day, we are now looking at a screen. And that disrupted industries that had so much time in. They were so comfortable. You know, an example of this is influencer marketing. Influencer marketing now is a staple. In 2007, a celebrity would not have been caught dead in an American commercial. Brad Pitt, George Clooney did watch ads in Europe, in Asia, but never in America. Today, some of the largest direct-to-consumer products are owned by celebrities because they own the distribution channel. Or influencer marketing in general has upended the makeup industry, for example. And you have all of these opportunities for people to use the technology at hand and find new ways to connect and find new ways to make stuff. Because ultimately, we're all trying to express ourselves. We're all trying to connect. We want to be heard. We want to be listened to. It's an amazing feeling to just be listened to by you all, and I'm deeply, deeply appreciative of it. And we want to listen. We want to hear great voices. We want to hear new ideas. We want to find people that do things like us and connect with them. And those disruptive technologies and the changing of times 15 years ago is very similar to what we're looking at today. And it doesn't happen overnight. But 15 years, or even the 4 or 5 years it took to talk about most of the events I just described, is not a terribly long time. It's about as long as it takes to get a 4-year degree. And we are seeing that today in a way that is unbelievably inspiring. We're seeing that opportunity present itself again in ways we haven't predicted before. And I think of what that teacher at UCLA gave me that night. And I think of it like maybe perhaps change the trajectory of my life. That sounds like a lot to say, but at the very least, it gave me rocket fuel. It gave me belief. It gave me the thought that I could contribute. and it gave me the idea that my ideas would matter if I was willing to put them out there. And that kicked off my dreams. From that, I was able to go do wonderful, wonderful things using digital media and the internet. Wonderful for me. Not necessarily grand scale things, but wonderful for me. You know, I made the first movie within a casual game. I made the first feature with Sony made by members of a single social network. I got to go all over the world making small projects with my friends. And then I heard of this idea because as I was beginning, I heard of this idea that's very, very, very often repeated, one for the real and one for the meal, right? Because we have to find a way to get paid while we do this. And that's something that everyone, while we're starting out and we're trying to develop our taste and develop our portfolio, you still have to have a job, you have to find a way. And because of digital media, I was able to find commercials. And through commercials, I made over 125 ads, and what ads taught me is what branding is all about. It got me to learn how the ad agencies were thinking, or how the company was thinking, and how it was changing. Because the change is where the opportunity happens. When we're comfortable, people stay the same. It's hard to break in. Things are going up, we keep doing business as usual. As things change, new opportunities present themselves. And that led me to meeting my business partner, Max. And Max and I were working on a Crash the Super Bowl ad, which was a cool Doritos challenge. I don't know if they still do it, but they put it out and said, anyone who wants to, you know, that year Michael Bay was the judge, and if you made an ad, the winner was gonna go on the Super Bowl. That was in 2011. Unbelievable to think you could take an individual's ad and put it out there. And Max and I met doing that, and Max had a really deep interest in the same things I was interested in. He was working, he was actually a Noman student. I don't know if y'all know that, but Max was a Noman student before, and then he dove right into being a visual effects artist, was a matte painter. And we shared a lot of ideas about how the industry was going and where this whole thing was heading. And that, I think, is what's key about this, is it's not good or bad where this is heading. I can frame this positively, but it's not good or bad, it's just real. Change. It's just constant. It's the only thing that actually exists. And in businesses, and in production of all kind, we want to standardize things. We want to be able to scale. We want to be able to do things over and over again and put a process around it and improve that process. But no matter what, there's change. And the rate of change changes based on external factors like we're seeing today. And if you are seeing it, the change is dramatic today. And that isn't to say that the change right now is not tough. Because change is tough. That is true. And you know, it's to a varying degree, that has always been true. But you're not in this room because you were looking for the easy path. The creative life is not the easy path. The creative life is the courageous path. And the creative life offers you the opportunities that easy will never give you. And that's why you're here on a Thursday night having this conversation or listening to this portion of this conversation. Because being a creative and being on the journey that each one of you are on is the hero's journey. You are just like the characters and the stories you are trying to tell. And you are out of the Shire. You are breaking status quo. You're looking for your opportunity to go find whatever dragon it is that's hiding the treasure you're looking for. And there will be crisis and challenge along the way, and that is the journey that you have asked for. That is the audacious move. And we can guarantee that on this map that you are looking to traverse, there be dragons. And that is what's so exciting about this. There's an idea of the bird and the branch. And the idea is there's a bird sitting on a branch. And the branch could break. The branch could shake the bird. And if the bird doesn't flap its wings, it falls to the ground with the branch. But if the bird realizes it has wings, it's now impermeable to the downfall, and all of the upside is possible. And I can't think of a better, more exciting analogy for where you all are. And learning to use your wings here and learning to find the new opportunity is what gets so exciting about where we are going. Because this new wave is fascinating. And what is happening for technology and digital media is perhaps one of the most exciting times to be doing what you're doing. What is happening in 3D technology, is astounding. What is happening in real time? CG supervisor of Marvel yesterday told me the real-time revolution is upon us. Really feels exciting to be part of that. What does that mean for us? How can you use game engines to make things better and faster than ever before? How can you use what's available to you through Unreal Engine in so many different ways? I can't tell you a recruiter I've talked to in the last 2 years who hasn't told me they are dying for more Unreal users. They're dying to get more game engine artists into their space, into their visual effects houses, into their pre-vis opportunities, and getting shots all the way to the screen, which is so unique, which creates so much opportunity. That 5 years ago, no one was using Unreal to make a movie. But now, it's permeating just about every industry. And that means no one else has more experience. There is no one who's been doing that for 20 years in an establishment, in a pipeline that they can rinse and repeat. And there's all kinds of opportunities like that. To name a few, we may not be talking about Unreal Editor for Fortnite. Interesting new opportunity. They took Unreal and put it into Fortnite. That's 500 million people that if you wanted to make a game, you could now reach. And I think they announced their numbers this month, and I think they paid out $120 million to a very small amount of creators on the platform creating experiences. Omniverse from NVIDIA, interesting. Where will that technology take people? What will happen when we start using multiple softwares together? When we can use a pipeline in new ways? Creates massive opportunity if you want to dive in and find something really exciting. Generative AI, big conversation. But it's not the whole conversation. It's not the whole conversation about artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence isn't even new, right? It's just newly buzzworthy. But if you read underneath the headlines, because the headlines are about quarterly reports, remember that. When you're being swayed by what mass media is worried about, remember they're talking about 90 days, they're not talking about your career. And if you think about your career, and how you can utilize this over a decade or two, there's a whole lot of unique opportunity for you to drive with. There's a whole lot of opportunity. And artificial intelligence is going to enable so much of what the virtual frontier is. It already does. 6 of 7 pixels rendered on an NVIDIA chip right now are rendered using AI. Tremendous opportunity for an individual to come out and make something in 3D. Also, if you've ever Googled anything, you've been using AI for a long time. If you've ever been on a social media platform, it's servicing AI. And there's a lot of new things that are going to put new tools into young people's hands and allow you to find new opportunities. And I say young people, but it's not just young people, it's young in the time into it. Because if you were 25 years in the business, and you want to stay in the game, you know this already. You've lived through many of these cycles. And you're continually looking for new opportunities. You're continually changing and growing. And that makes this so deeply, terrifically exciting. And all of the fear is like saying, oh, the internet's here. No one needs to know anything anymore. Therefore, humans will be irrelevant in their knowledge base. No one will have a conversation anymore. But that's not what happened. Every person in this room could tell you any tiny detail of any topic in a matter of moments from Googling it, but that hasn't made humans irrelevant. It has just enabled humans to go to the next level. which is terrifically exciting. You have a point on this. Absolutely right. We have more access to immediate information, but our retention ability to retain that information is going down. And that's true. That's changing the way our brains work. But that's change, and that will continue to be the constant here for us. And so if we think about what we want, that is where this gets really exciting. And that is where all of this conversation of the virtual frontier is heading. And it's really important that people in this room and people in this industry think about what they do want to happen. Because where your focus goes, energy flows. Another way of putting that is what you think you become. Buddha said that. And it's so deeply true. Because you are all here because you have vivid imaginations. You are all here because you're visionaries and you're shapers. And you want to see your ideas out in the world. So it matters deeply the thoughts that you put in. And if you're thinking about how not to fail, you're gonna have a safe time. But instead, if you're thinking about what could you become, you get so much more opportunity. And you multiply your upside. And at this stage of your life, that's what you want to be looking for. There's an idea if you're driving and there's telephone poles going past you, and you keep staring at the telephone poles, worried that you're gonna hit it, all of a sudden you end up crashing into a telephone pole. But if instead you look down the road at the path that you want to be carving, you end up down the path that you want to be carving. So a great way to figure out what you want, because the key to growing up is figuring out who you are and who you want to be. And that has nothing to do with what stage you are in life. Most people don't do that in their life. Most people don't get to do that transition. But the key to figuring out what you want in life is knowing what you value and what you care about, because creation and your experience in this world is atomic, just like the very fabric of life is atomic. It starts with you. And you have to get your inner circle communicating well with itself. And then if you do that, you can then communicate that to a partner or to a team or to a company. And once you get communicating with a group and a team, you can do amazing things for a larger group, a community. And then you can figure out exactly who of the people who haven't heard of you yet are the right people to come into your sphere. Because not all partners will be the right partners for you. So thinking about what do you actually want in your life, and not getting lost living someone else's values, which is such an easy thing to do. You know, you could say, hey, I want to go work for Disney because I love Disney's movies. I have always loved Disney's movies. I want to create characters every day, and I want to live in that day to day. And then at some point, that will build up to something, but I want to be task-oriented and create and create and create there. That's a terrific reason, and if that's true for you, do that. Pursue that. But if you're saying, hey, I think if I go work at Disney, my parents will feel like I've made it. You may want to ask yourself, how much of your time do you want to spend down that track? And that might be an important track for you. You may say, hey, my high school ex really loved Disney movies, and they're going to see me there. And then you're on a bad path. And don't spend much time, if you can, on those paths. Instead, think about what it is that you need in life. And this is, I didn't come up with this, but there's many different versions of the hierarchy of human needs. But as you go up the ladder, this is a decision-making framework that you can use to help you find what it is that you actually care about. Because certainty is what we all need. Doesn't matter who you are or what position you are in your life. Tell me you're going to die tomorrow and nothing else matters. Tell me you don't have a job tomorrow and you all of a sudden have to build certainty for you. So you have to go figure that out. You have to maintain your health. You have to get a job. You have to exist in the world. But then once you get so much certainty and safety in your life, you want surprise. You want uncertainty. You want to mix it up a little bit. So those first two are in conflict with each other. The next one is you want to be significant. You want to feel what you do matters in life. And that doesn't mean you have to be on the big screen. You can get significance out of making someone smile. You can get significance out of cleaning the house for your roommates. You can get significance out of calling your mom. But when you become so significant, so unique, people go, man, there's no one like you. You feel alone. And so you want connection, you want love. They say most people can't handle love, so they settle for connection. But you'll see that 3 and 4 are in conflict with each other. And then there's a line here, because these higher spiritual needs, growth and contribution, are not in conflict with each other. And that offers you tremendous opportunity to make decisions, if you can handle the first 4, based on growth and contribution. And if you make your decisions for those needs, magic can happen in your life in so many different ways. So, growth. We talk at KitBash about growth a ton. We're kind of obsessed with it as people, and the people who gravitate towards KitBash are obsessed with the idea of being better than we were yesterday. And we say, if we can do that every day, if you can live in the process of growing, magic happens along the way, if you can stay day to day and focus on it. And so we have 4 company principles. The first 3, the first one is strive for excellence. The second one is commit to growth. And the third one is prioritize rest. Because we think growth equals stress plus rest. And the stress is often not the hard part for people who are super passionate. Think about a time in your life where you stayed up till 5 o'clock in the morning, if you're a night person, but where you stayed working at a project for way longer than you thought you would have because you were so deeply passionate about it and time flew by and you were in the zone and all of a sudden, where did that go? Where did the time go? You didn't even notice, but you were stressed. You hadn't drank water, you hadn't slept, you hadn't gone and exercised, and all of a sudden your body developed stress, but you may not even realize it because you like the stress. And that is a thing for high achievers. If that's a pattern for you, focus on that. Think about that. But what also high achievers seem to forget is rest is so paramountly important because you cannot grow if you do not recover. And so we actually mandate rest. We mandate taking the time because we believe in those 3 so deeply as how we get to growth. And then our 4th is champion one another because we believe that being part of something bigger than yourself is the highest level of human happiness. And that when you go towards something together with people, you get what we say is 1 + 1 = 3, which is terrible math, but I hope you get the point. Because it offers us the opportunity to make decisions that will help the team. And when we make decisions that will help the team, we get that deep human need of contribution. And that doesn't mean that you have to dedicate your life to solving human hunger. If that's not what you want to do, if that is what you want to do, outstanding. But you can get contribution and you can make decisions in your life that will lead you to contributing to something in so many ways. So, where we are now. The little things will change. Mentioned we were here 4 years ago, and it was December of 2019. Max and I gave a talk, which was the last talk of the decade, and we talked about how things were going to change here, but we could not have predicted what's happened here in the last 4 years. Because it has changed in so many ways, and it will continue at an accelerated rate. The details of that will change. But the big things will stay constant. And if you can do the figure out what you want out of this life and get really deeply aligned with that, you'll be able to fly when the branch shakes. And if you're able to fly when the branch shakes, you'll find other people who want to fly in the same ways that you do. And that is what we call collaborative partnership. And the future of everything is in collaborative partnerships. It is in how well we choose to work with people. And those are in the micro decisions you'll make every day, in the conversations you have with strangers and deep partners alike. And if you can value that, and you remind yourself of that, and you get better at conflict resolution, you get better at teamwork, and you get better at realizing when someone doesn't align with you, that will set you on the right track. Atomically, you figure out what works for you, then you put other people and you go together on that. And you have to value that. You have to value partnerships of all kind. And you have to deeply take it seriously. Because there aren't, I'm gonna talk about this space specifically, but take those thoughts, if those are helpful to you, and use them in every part of your life and you'll find what it is that matters to you. But on the virtual frontier aspect of this, there aren't nearly enough of us here yet. You're still early, if you can believe it. You're still early to where this whole thing goes. And the opportunities are just beginning in so many ways, and there aren't nearly enough people here working together in good ways to service the rising demand of what the virtual frontier will promise. And this will be predicated upon what we do next, how we work together. I am here because I want to connect with you. I am here because I want to work with you all. I am here because I deeply believe what we can do together could change the fabric of humanity. And I think we have a slim window. A decade's not a long time. But what happens next over this decade will dictate decades to come and generations to come. And if we can go at this together, if we can find really great ways to do things together using new tools and collaborate with one another, we have a real opportunity. We have an incredible impact. We have an incredible opportunity to have incredible impact. And if we can take that with great enthusiasm and be as serious as we are passionate about it, we get to shape chapters here. So that brings us to tonight. Danar Worya is here, and he's gonna come up in just a few moments. But talking about collaborative partnership, you're gonna get to see some amazing collaborative thoughts from Danar in so many different ways. He's worked on Shazam and Last of Us and projects that we talked about earlier. And tonight he's gonna be working with a new tool that we have been developing in great collaboration with our community called Cargo. And we're gonna talk about each of these, but briefly on KitBash. KitBash is on a mission to enable and inspire creators of the virtual frontier. That is what we talk about each day and how we talk about doing it. You'll notice that's not about making assets, which if you've heard about us, you may know that is what we do. We make digital assets. And Max and I, as I was talking about this before, we were good buddies. It's funny, because that's about right. I didn't have a tie, he didn't have a jacket, but that's about as complementary of opposites as we could become. I don't know how we got into this space, but there is us talking about the same ideas and where we realized that we were collaborative in this way, that we matched each other. Because Max and I will look at two things, one thing from the same angle, I mean one thing from completely different angles. And we get to value each other's opinion because what we call each other is complementary opposites. And so we began talking about this together back then. And we began talking about how this was going to change. And we said, man, in 2025, when computer latency picks up to the conversation we're talking about the virtual frontier, we're going to have an awesome company. And then 10 hours later, 10 years later, and 10 hours later in the conversation, middle of the last decade, we said, well, what could we do now? How could we contribute to what we're working on? And so we made a game. We made a game called Sleep Tight. And it was the first Unreal game to port to Nintendo Switch. And we got a bunch of buddies. Max had spent a long time working in visual effects. He was an art director and matte painter. He worked on Halo and Far Cry and Game of Thrones and Godzilla and just about every large IP you can imagine. We were able to go to some of his friends, some of his previous collaborative partners, and say, hey, you want to work on this wild idea that we're doing? You want to help us make a story about kids in their room building pillow forts and fighting monsters that come every night? And we got artists from Zootopia and Wreck-It Ralph and Big Hero 6 to come help us build the world. And while we were doing that, we knew that assets were a big problem for studios. Asset management and asset pipelines in studios are very difficult. Studios are spending 30 to 50% of their budgets making assets. At the end of the show, they archive them to tape, they give them to the studio, and then they have to go remake them again. and management of assets over time and upgrading assets and making a premium asset is a deeply complex problem. We knew that was a problem for studios, but while we made Sleep Tight, we realized it was a completely prohibitive problem for an individual. If you didn't have access to world-class assets, an individual couldn't realize their dreams. And so in 2017, 2018, we started thinking about this problem, and we had the idea on a napkin and over a croissant at E3 here in LA. We were walking into E3 at Nintendo. We were ready to go with our launch in 100 days from then, because E3 was in May and we were gonna launch in September. And we walk into E3 and Nintendo announces in the same week as our launch a Pokemon game and the next week a Super Mario Brothers game. And we said, we're probably not launching this year. And so we walked out of E3 and went and had a cup of coffee and said, well, what could we do now? We set this goal to launch in 100 days, what could we do with it? And we wrote the idea of KitBash on a napkin. And 100 days later, we launched the asset library. And then we said, what's important is that we grow over time. What's important is that we build on this over time. So we committed to releasing a new kit every month. And we did that, and now today we have over 100 kits out in the world. But what those 100 kits have been able to do is reach our community of artists in over 180 countries who were able to realize their visions and realize their dreams in ways they never thought they could. And because we gave them an enablement of the tool and a bit of inspiration for what you could do, they went and did amazing things and continue to do amazing things every day. Many people here have seen, we watch the reels of Noman every year and we get super excited to see how cool some of the work is that you all are doing. And when you go walk into your next job, or when you put out your own personal piece, how that's helped you do it. And then we've gotten to work with the studios. We've gotten to work with really fantastic collaborative partners along the way. We work with 1,200 studios worldwide who have found that they changed their pipes for this. They found new ways and faster and better ways to iterate ideas, or to make their concepts better, or to make their previs better, or to take those assets and use them in final renders that are ending up on the screen of all shapes and sizes. Because we went out to enable them. We went out to inspire them. We did not set out to make assets, which has led us continually down this path. And these are incredible projects that they have made with kits. They have said awesome things about them and been incredibly wonderful teammates to us along the way, and have helped us through this process in so many ways. Because we're not here to make and sell assets. We're here to enable and inspire the creators of the virtual frontier. And that's what we work for every day. And that has naturally led us from the asset problem to the asset management problem. Because what good are infinite assets if you can't find any of them? What good are infinite assets if you can't use them? What good is it to have access to all of these things if you can't import them into your software or share them with a teammate? And so by staying to what do we actually want to do, our mission, and our using our company values to help us go along the mission, it just naturally progressed us to making the next step of that, which I'm so excited to have Danar Worya here to show you all around that. So would you please welcome Danar to the stage.
Yes, sir. Hello, hello. Hello. Can you guys hear me? Yeah. All right. Yeah. What's up, everybody? Thank you all for having me here. This is such an honor. I could tell you, when I was younger, I was always like dreaming to be in Gnomon and studying here and everything. And like the fact that I'm here in front of you guys is such a blessing. And you know, before we start, I thought let us show them like what Cargo does in this video we have, right?
Okay.
Before we actually go into the demo, right? All right. We'll be right back.
Well, thanks for that, Danar, and thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, tell us while this is booting up, tell us a bit about, just give a little bit of background on how you dove in and why you chose this industry for you.
Right. So I guess just like everybody else, you know, when I was young, there was a lot of like films, cartoons, games, and when I started playing them or seeing them, for some reason there was always this itchy feeling in me, like, you know, I want to be part of that. I want to inspire people like this inspired me. So I got into college and I was always drawing, but I was never good at school. Like, I was not a smart kid if you go it based off the school logistics. But I was always like drawing and doing my own thing, and by chance I got introduced into concept art, and I just remember as a day, as if it was yesterday, a friend of mine was just typed in Google concept art, and the first few stuff I knew, I saw, and he actually told me, like, you can make a living out of this. And the moment that I heard that, immediately the day after, I was like, all right, let's see what I like. And the mission right now is, I don't know what I'm gonna do in the bigger picture, but I know what the next step is. So we're just go by step and slowly building up, and then trusting the process and trusting yourself that you will know along the way which direction to go.
Well, and to that point, you've had so many incredible steps along the way.
Yeah.
And I know from personally knowing you, I know how much it has taken from you, how much it has cost you to create and to go through the process of getting through it. How do you, in the focus of step by step, how do you manage your process? Because I know you have, we were talking about the atomic circle. I know you've spent a lot of time getting your own instrument to perform the way you want to.
Yeah, I think, so the thing about art is, the thing for me is, the beauty about art is, I'm at a stage in my life where I noticed that getting better at art is getting to know myself and knowing what actually drives me, or, you know, quote unquote, what are my vulnerabilities, so I can work with that instead of like complaining about it. So throughout this whole process, and of course this is like V6, this is version 6 Photoshop of me. This is not the guy that started and I already knew where I'm gonna end up. No, this is like V6, V7, V8, and that's what you need to do, is you're re-peeling yourself like a snake, and then in your next stage of peeling, you know what the direction should be. And the thing about art is, you know, you were beautifully talking about this, is it's a constant thing. It's not like creativity, when you're an artist, it's not, oh, I need to work on my art, I need to get better at it. That's in the beginning parts. Eventually, that becomes part of you. So getting better at art, that is already like breathing. And the next growth to that is, all right, who am I? What inspired me, actually, right? Not what inspired this art director that is making this movie and is hiring me, because I already went through that. What inspires me? And the question to that is, and this is why I love art, is you go back to your younger self, because creativity and art is a young man's sport. Everything almost in life is a young man's sport. If you look at fighting, if you look at boxing, the younger you are, the more sharper you are, the more fearless you are. So what I mean with that is, I'm channeling back to when I was 15, 16, 17, and at that time when I was looking at anime, when I was playing games, when I was looking at films. Because right now when I'm doing that, my logical brain just turns it off, and it's like, oh yeah, the lighting is there, and this is this, and this is this. So what became art for me right now, it's a feeling. I feel like we're like visual philosophers. Everybody has this feeling, but we are the one that tries to grasp it and put it in visuals and see if we can, is that the same feeling that thousands and millions of people across the world feels. And maybe that thing that you put on screen or image or whatever, that connects with millions of people. But we don't know that yet. And this is why we're here, to self-express. Mm. And, you know, going into what you said about AI, very scary, genuinely, like, I was scared. This year, 60% of my professional friends, from art directors to senior, like, who worked on Lord of the Rings, whatever, they're looking for jobs. Yes, it is scary. But that's the thing, is like, out of fear comes greatness, right? Comfortability is the killer of creativity for me. And I've noticed that about myself. I've noticed, for example, when I'm in LA, last year I was here for 3 months. When I'm at home and I'm getting a project or a briefing, I stress out so much. Trust me, it doesn't matter how good you are, that stress stays, because that's your insecurity, right? Because that's the biggest task I have in life. Everything else around my life, sleeping, going out, all that, I already figured that out because I've repeated that for years and years around this place called the Netherlands for me. But when I came to LA, all of a sudden, that's not that hard anymore, because now I have to survive here. It's a different culture. I have to learn how to ride here, like drive here, it's a bit different. People communicate different. So all the challenges, when it's shifting towards life, then art becomes a bit more easier. Because I already figured this side out. So why is that hard? So it's this balance in life where if it becomes too comfortable, you will start to get bored. And this boring thing is because an artist needs to be challenged. And then you kind of go into the other side of being challenged. And that challenge is to figure out what you want to do when you're going back to the comfort zone and growing towards the challenge again.
Love that. Well, let's next dive in and take a look at this, and we'll continue.
So,
because I know you have a lot that you want to express here, and a lot of challenge around the art you want to describe.
So I wanted to talk about cargo, why this is so important, or why this is so special for me. I got the opportunity to work on this, do a demo, and the great thing about this is, you know, it's just like two clicks away. And what this means is I have so much time to actually focus on the idea, the selling point, and less on the technicalities of, hey, how does this building look? How do I build this? Hey, how do I texture that area? Now you're fully focused on the idea, and you can just swap out ideas. And as a creator, this is so great because, you know, in our industry, we may know what kid bashing is. And this is like a small percentage, but outside the world, they think you built all this. And you know, there's a saying, fake it till you make it. And that applies to whatever level you are as an artist. Let's say you're the top peak best artist. You still have to fake that you're still better than that. If you're Super Saiyan 1, you have to claim that you're Super Saiyan 2 until you get to the Super Saiyan 2. Then you claim you're Super Saiyan 3, right? Because this is the great thing about cargo is there's so much options here to choose from that my ideas are coming directly when I'm looking at it instead of like trying to figure out what the idea is. It's like equal to having a blank page and trying to paint that in, right? In traditional painting, we always paint the blank page like orange first, right? Or brown, because you know the blank page is too scary. It's the same with cargo. You know, sometimes I just put stuff in, I don't even know what's gonna happen, and then I'll find it. And this is the beauty about it, is not only can you, you know, it's optimized in the sizing, so you don't have to be afraid of, oh, can my PC handle it? But it's also optimized in such a way, so let's download one of these assets, you know, and go ahead.
Well, and you know, maybe too, if you haven't seen cargo before, this is it, and it has all of the kits broken out. And as Danar was saying, he just clicks on a kit. And then you can see each piece as individual assets, so that within one click you can download and import it to whatever DCC that you're using.
And the great thing about this is not only can you download the assets, obviously you also have the materials, and you can also import that immediately. So it kind of, what this feels like is like, you know, back in the day when you bought this whole set and you open it up, there's the paper and there's the markers, there's this, there's that, it's all into one thing. You don't have to actually individually buy all this stuff. It kind of feels like this is the set for that. And cargo doesn't mean you're gonna use this as the end result. No, you can use this for everything. It doesn't matter what, even if you just want to play around and get some ideas. And this is why it's built for all aspects of creativity, from post-production to post-production, pre-production, and post-production. Mm-hmm. It can still apply to that. And the great thing is when you are not focused on the modeling parts like we are doing here, then you can fully focus on the storytelling. Let me check. It should. I think we already have one. Let's download this one. So it's in queue. And if we go to Blender, so let me already just start by making a floor plane. And what I like to do usually in 3D is, before we actually delve into the detailing and everything and to the asset, I'm thinking like, all right, let's start easy, let's start simple. And what do we mean with that? Basic camera. Navigation, walk, there you go. Now, I'm trying to judge my plane, kind of like what camera angle am I looking for? Let's say we do it like this, with the camera. And by the way, while I'm working, you guys can also, if you have any questions, just hit me up, I can.
Well, and I have a question, is if we can talk about this while you're working. Because you were describing how you're constantly looking to go to the next level, right?
Yeah.
And there's a famous Ira Glass quote where he talks about our taste, mm-hmm. and that you got into this space because you have taste. There's something that you like, and you have a feeling about things that you want to express.
Yeah.
But your skills are not to your taste.
No.
And there's this gap that we have to deal with along the way, and it sounds like, as you're describing, that gap never goes away. The goalposts just move. But how do you find and prioritize where you want to improve and how you're going to improve with it?
Let's see. Could not locate your software. Let me fix this first. Well, I think the prioritizing. Is this the? Apologies, guys. I think I have so many Blender versions here. Blender 3.6 should be this one. Well, so going back to that, prioritizing is mainly, it's not only about what you like, but also looking at what's in right now for the younger generation and trying to understand that. So in the sense of, for example, in music, you know, I work with artists like will.i.am or Kid Cudi, and what I notice about these artists is when you're talking with them or trying to converse with them, I don't feel like there's an age that I'm talking with you, like there's no, oh, this guy is 50 years old and I'm like 23 years old, mm-hmm. or there's an age gap. No, they still are as young in spirit as they were when they started out. So by noticing that, that means that not only are they trying to do what they like, but they're trying to understand what the younger generation likes and find a version of themselves within that, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And this is, again, we go back to AI and art, and this is the challenge for you guys now, is like finding yourself within this realm of what is happening right now. Because ask yourself this question, if Da Vinci were to live right now, would he be sculpting or would he be using ZBrush and doing the sculpting, right? Because what is more logical? Was he sculpting with, like, you know, sticks and knives, or was he sculpting with rocks? No, he had a hammer and mm-hmm. because that was the most advanced technology that they had at that time. So we have to go with the growth of the technology that we have. And unfortunately, right now we're being challenged because what we 2 years thought was the future for us, which is, you know, we keep on going, doing concept art and like repainting 1,000 faces, and then you get really good at that face, and then hopefully you work for Marvel. The whole plane is changed. That doesn't mean that what you're learning in art is not useful. That just means that you have a sword in your arsenal that another person doesn't have, and that's experience. An experience you can't buy. Experience you have to earn. An experience of being an artist and growing from that, and learning how lighting works, and who Rembrandt is, and why he paints a certain way, and actually learning how to paint in colors. This will all transfer into using AI because you already know what works. this is the whole idea about concept art. Being the person, you are getting hired because you're one of the guys on the ship that's steering the way towards the right direction. You don't know what the right direction is, but the feeling is there. And to get there, it doesn't matter right now what in your arsenal is, it's important, the story and the message, because art is communication at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. It's a language.
Mm-hmm. So I know you're
I'm kind of,
we have a connection issue here.
I think that should be.
While you're teeing that up, how are we doing? Anyone have things they would like to contribute to the conversation or ask questions?
Yes.
Okay, we'll get to them later too.
Oh, wait. No.
Please. Okay, I think we got a mic coming to you too.
Sorry, can you repeat the question? So with the advent of technology and the change in, I guess, be nice and say the change in skills that go along with that. How do you feel about like the loss of traditional skills? People who actually can draw, creating things versus people who just bash photos together or come up, you know, kit bash things. And I'm not against kit bashing, but I've seen, like, I've worked with some younger people that have come into our studio and done stuff. And while very technically correct, it runs well, it looks good, because I do virtual production, so I'm an environment artist at Unreal. We use your stuff all the time. But what ends up happening is they give you a very technically correct picture, exactly whatever it was they were, but it does not look very good. And then I end up having to go back in, change the lighting, change the colors, set a mood to it, and do things like that. And a lot of it came down to, because I have a very traditional background, I learned illustration, painting, and all that stuff before I got into 3D. So
you raise fantastic points, and I think it's a terrific conversation at Nomen, because there is no substitute for foundational artistic background, right? The pencil or the magic marker or the Wacom tablet doesn't change what the creator is able what lives beneath the creative landscape, right? And so we must, in order to realize your vision or to understand the things that you want to, the tool won't do the work for you. And I think that's what you're getting at, is that it's so important that the actual creator there. These aren't cheat codes, these are tools to enable and inspire you to do different things, but getting yourself along the path and teaching actual craft and having actual craft and working on craft cannot be substituted by a sharper chisel.
Oh, there we go.
Describing about how new tools are changing things and giving new opportunity, but also shifting the way business is done.
All right.
But so what I've seen is going from like a very good skill to people who, and not from here, you know, but from other places, graduate can't draw a self portrait. Yeah, their ability to actually draw or do skills lacks severely, but the professionals working in the industry because they know somebody, and they can kind of do some stuff, mix some things together, bash some photos together, and kind of get an idea. Provided that it's usually like middle and low tier studios that don't really care what they get as long as they get something. There's this ongoing, like, it's like a decline in skill.
Well, and I think that becomes the onus on the individual creator to find what their taste is and to connect the pieces of the puzzle there and the leadership behind it too, to connect and find the right ways to make the expressions that you're trying to make. And I think, to your point, I think it comes down to the people, right? And the people define what actually comes from using these tools. Thank you for that. How are we doing today?
Yeah, it's going great. And to add to that, for the people you're saying that, you know, focused on the skill and doing and all that, I think that's great, and I love that. I still believe that I'm a guy who focuses on skill, but when I'm looking at a film like Neil Blomkamp, I'm not thinking, how did he do that? I'm just looking at the end result. And at the end of the day, you created the skill, and the skill is not only in your hand, it's the logic and the information you built in your brain that could get you there. And if that's through a pencil, or if that's through 3D, or if that's through guiding groups towards a direction, it's still the idea that you had in your head. Like, for example, you know, when we think about directors, we think like, oh, they're holding everybody's hand and like, do this and do that. No, it's just, he is the group guidance, as in like, he just should know what the best is in everybody and guide them. And that's the same thing about AI. Eventually, hopefully, is we all become so good that each of you can run your own small studio because you already have the vision for everything, right? And how I'm envisioning it is like in 10 years, a kid from Somalia who's like 12 years old is gonna make a game because it's just a couple of buttons away and is gonna earn like $30 million. Why? Because he's fearless. He just does. Whereas we're hesitant, you know? Yeah, but I paint for 6 years. I don't know if I should try that. No, you should. And sometimes we actually let that go and you try something else and you go back, then you get better at your own work even though you didn't touch it. It's a yin-yang thing. This is a reason why logistics of concept art not only applies to only art, you know, the 80-20% rule, 50-50, keeping it simple, noise balance, that also applies to life, right? The bigger picture, keeping it simple. And when you kind of find that connection of what you learn through art and you apply that to your life, then I can guarantee you there is no failure. Only failure is just the bumps along the way. And eventually you'll get there. And I hope that everybody gets there, because when you guys get there, that makes me nervous, because that means my position is not set. So that means I have to stay creative as well. And this is the we all need each other. Students need the professionals, professionals need the students. You guys inspire us and we inspire you. I hope that's a good answer. Import. So check this out. What's the beauty about these assets? Now it's importing. First of all, when you downloaded KitBash from the previous versions, the kits, it's all in one scene. And that only took me, like, all due respect. Now that Cargo is out, you know, we can talk about that. That took me like at least 5 minutes to figure out stuff and to, you know, to see what works and what not. And then within each asset, like all the smaller details were all separate and they were all in the groups. And I'm a type of guy, my brain doesn't work logic, my brain works in chaos. But it's only chaos that I can decide and not somebody else. But the beauty about this right now is, check this, it's just one thing, right? And the cool thing is, now, how many faces? This is like 1.3 million faces. So if you copy this, player end, keep transformation. Let's focus on this. Oh, it doesn't have a background. All right, downloads, HDRI. Look, it even fits the HDRI style. You see that? I did it, that was not planned. But if we just focus mainly on the model itself, this is Legos. I want you guys to think in Legos ideas, right? And the beauty about KitBash is, like, you know when you're a kid and you have like different type of Legos and they all don't fit with each other, but you still force it on each other and you make something great out of it? This is kind of what you can use Cargo as. And it's only your thinking that makes it Legos. The person that you're selling it to, they think you built that, right? But the logics, the KitBashing, going back to that, you know, when you can use it, for me, you can use it when you know you can rebuild this. When I know I can do this, why would I redo it again? And again and again. No, I already proved myself. And this is very important for me, is, you know, you have in Arabic, you have this saying where they say, it was sabr and qana'at. Sabr means patience, and qana'at means conviction, like in anime, right? You know, sometimes when the character bosses, like, powers up, and the other guy asks, like, oh, what happened to him? And the other dude is like, yeah, he's convinced. You need conviction. Once you're convinced that you're going to do concept art, then it's the patient game of knowing that you're going to get there and trying to believing it until you get there. And then it kind of, you know, once you get there, then the conviction of the next step comes, and then the patience comes in, and then you play with that again. And the beauty about this one is, if I do this now and I go to decimate, and let's say it's too heavy, right? And this is what I often do. I can still decimate it like 0.3. All right. So right now it's 120,000 polygons versus like 500,000, right? And this is the beauty. If we now render both, you barely see the difference. And this is what I mean with, like, that's the beauty about being a 2D artist going into 3D, is we know this is enough. This is like, it's the logics of, if it's two brush strokes, then why would you go into detail in an image, right? If you know that it's only two brush strokes. And it's the same thing for 3D. If I know it's in my image is gonna be this far, then that's the two brush stroke logic. As in, like, there's no detail. I don't need the detail. And this is why it's so beautiful about Cargo and about KitBash. It's the, you're the character, and it's the clothes you're putting onto your character, right? And if it's from distant, if it's from far, if it's from close up, it's that's the beauty about it. There's so many logics and options and ideas to think about. And, you know, let's say you want to go crazy. We want a sci-fi world where these buildings are super tall. Cursor to select it, set origin 3D cursor, and then what we do is we mirror Z. Look, you can start making your own type of designs, right? When you go into edit, and look at that. This is my building. This is not Cargo's building. I just made this. They gave me the ingredients, but I made this. And if KitBash was obsolete, then that's the same logic as, why do people still go to different type of Italian places if you can make your own spaghetti? You already have the ingredient, right? But why do we go? It's the same logics. KitBash gave you guys the ingredient, and now it's your turn to make this spaghetti unique. And it's usually the 5% that makes it unique, and that's on you. So now that we figured this out, let's make a small scene.
While you're keying that up, I know we had a question over here.
Yeah.
I had a question. I've been to a lot of Nomen events, and I've heard a lot of questions, and it all often leads back to creativity. I feel like I live in a generation where everything is somehow made better, but it's still similar, or it's the same base idea. I guess my question would be personally to both of you is, how do you guys stay creative in a way that's not repeating itself? Or in general, I feel
that's
like creativity
question.
Is quite emotional sometimes too.
Mm-hmm. Please.
That's a great question. In other words, how do you renew something that's already been done constantly, right? By accepting the fact that nothing is special. Everything has been done before. Let me use examples, right? Kojima, Metal Gear Solid, great, beautiful, right? If you think about it, I could never done that. Why? Because it's from an objective point of view, from a Japanese man that watched American films, and even if the logistic of the film didn't make sense, in his brain it made a new connection. And if you type in Snake Plissken, Escape from LA, it's the exact design that he used for Snake in the games. 101, but we still accept it. Why? Because that's the thing that inspired him. Quentin Tarantino, man, sometimes he's like taking shot by shot of stuff that he got inspired by. And millions of others saw that same film, but only he saw it in a way that he thought he could make use of it. Same logistic goes for you, right? If somebody pours a glass of cola for both of us, probably I taste it just a bit different than you, and I express it just a bit different than you, right? And that's what makes something that is very common unique. It's your perspective, and it's your input that makes it unique, right? We're at a stage right now in art where not only your art is what's going to sell it, it's also your personality. And you may think, yeah, but what is my personality? How do I you know, evolve my personality? Well, it's like art. How do you get better at drawing faces? Draw that eye 2,000 times, and then you get better at drawing eyes, right? How do you get better at conversing? Go out, be with friends. This is actually a job. Like, I see going out with friends and going out a date or whatever, I see it as a job, because if I'm constantly in my room and all of a sudden I get thrown into Gnomon workshop and I've never conversed with somebody for like 2-3 months, I can't come out of my words because I've been too much here, right? Sometimes you have to go out. And when you're out and you come back, all of a sudden new ideas pop up.
It's an interesting framing. I think it's a really fascinating question too. How do you be creative in a world with so much? And I think to Danar's point, not being so concerned with being the only thing that ever did that one thought, but knowing that your expression is unique, even if you're using words that other people have said. Pop music is an amazing look at this, right? There's only so many chords, and most pop songs are all following the same chords, and almost all pop songs are verse, chorus, bridge, double chorus, and we're done. But that structure then allows people to play within it. And finding the rules, right, or finding the structure, and then putting your own variation on the structure based on what you feel, allows you to make something that is uniquely yours. Doesn't mean, you know, if you're playing a guitar, that you're the first and only person to ever play a note on a guitar. It just means that you're expressing it in that way. Or if you're using a tool of any kind, or you're making a movie, finding the right pocket that feels true to you, regardless of whether you're the only person to ever think of that shot in history, is not the key point. And still allows you to be creative without putting the pressure on yourself of, I need to do something that no one has ever done or thought of, which actually just becomes irrelevant. It's a cool question, though.
Great question.
All right, so I missed a couple chapters here tonight. Walk us through what you've done.
So right now, what I did is I had like a couple of buildings from the Aftermath and the other, you know, my favorite sets, obviously. I call these the Last of Us kits. Like, just without these kits, half of my work wouldn't exist. Yeah, I'm using the Aftermath, playing a bit with Wasteland, Future Slums, Warzone, kind of staying in the main, you know, nieces and nephews. And then what I'm trying to show as well is like, you know, materials side. You can actually just, right, like we go to concrete or destructive. Just found like one of these ground materials that I thought could be super useful. And so this is the basis. All right. This is the basis here.
Can I touch on just a couple things?
Of course.
You just said, of course, Danar worked on Last of Us Part 2 and used the kits that he just described. And Last of Us is such a beloved series for us because Last of Us Part 2 was the first big game that used KitBash right when we came out. And then they used the kits in the refurb of Part 1. And then now in the TV show, they've used the kits in a number of different ways. And what Danar was describing of the, I think he said the nieces and nephews, you know, what one thing that we really wanted here is we have all of these kits, and the way it worked before is you get a kit, and you have to make a bunch of decisions. You have to decide, do I want Warzone, or do I want Aftermath, or do I want Wasteland? And what we wanted Cargo to do was allow you to blend them together in new and unique ways, and to find your own expressions of these things, and be able to take a singular building or even a singular prop of one kit and bash it together with another, so that you could be able to quickly iterate on your ideas and not have to spend your time of thinking, oh, I'm limited to the one kit I have or the selection of kits I have. Instead, now you can have access to all of the kits as individuals, and then the materials too, which allows you to create new things from them and to create variations of them that that we may not have seen before.
So right now, what we're gonna do is, what I always do is make a base. So let's put some lighting in. And I guess what really helped me out kind of getting to the next stage is, you know, what the toughest thing about art is, like finding your own progress or process. And what does that mean is figuring out how your brain solves form language or lighting or coloring. Like, for example, I really tried drawing like you guys, but I can't. I don't know why. My brain just doesn't pick up form language that way. But for some reason, when I started sculpting, all of a sudden, it actually understood form. So apparently, my brain works in that sense, where I do 3D and it helps me understand form. And for somebody else, they're really good at drawing that. So this is the beauty about art, is it's not only like one way of doing it, it's like within every section, there's like thousands of ways of doing it. It's like the Dark Souls games, right? Yeah, you start, you know, you're butt naked, and then you have to choose your XPs. And instead of XPs, it's like, all right, what do you want to do? Like, you know, figure drawing, lighting, form language, whatever. And then you have to decide before that, you know, what kind of mage are you? Are you a mage? Are you a barbarian? Are you this? Are you that? So all these choices will help you, because in the first stages of your career, you kind of have to know a direction of, hey, I'm gonna do characters, so that means my focus is not gonna be on environments, it's gonna be on, you know, form language, it's gonna be on anatomy, it's gonna be on this, on that, until you beat the first boss, right? And the first boss is what? Your first job. That's your first boss. Then the second boss comes. That's your second job. That's like Marvel. Then the third boss, that's DC, whatever. And the funny thing is, after these games, right, usually at the end, who do you fight? It's like a reflection of yourself, right? Because that's the end goal of an artist. And I want you all to think like this. I genuinely want that. See these studios as not the end goal. See these studios as the bosses. You need to be challenged to know what your worth is. Because at the end, I want each and every individual here to make their own game, to make their own film, to make their own manga, to make their own comic. And all you're doing is just getting, you know, experience from this guy and from that and this, and knowing, you know, I can like banter with this samurai and I don't need to kill him, but I just need to know that I'm strong enough to do it on my own. And like he said, you are the main character. This is my shonen. I am in season 5 right now. And they just renewed it for another 6 seasons, right? So you don't know when the renewal is until it gets super good. And in season 2, I thought I'm gonna be canceled at season 3. So, you know, like, this is life. This is the beauty about it, not knowing. Let's see. So right now, this is what I meant with like, all right, I want some 2D logics into it. And how are we gonna do that? Gonna put like a flat background into it.
Please. Sorry, Chris has got a microphone coming to you.
Okay, I've been a fan of Gnomon for quite some time, and at SIGGRAPH, a number of booths I went to, I said, you gotta talk to some of these kids at Gnomon for talent. And since I'm not active in this, but I have ideas, especially related to fashion industry, elements in a composition, that's what this is, and I asked so many people at booths that are working with content, world building and being able to move elements around quickly and create different textures, backgrounds, etc. Do you have anything like that? And I said, kind of walked out of the show thinking, well, unreal. I got to build it. I don't know how to build it. I don't have time to build it. The kids at Nomon could probably take on a project, but no, that's not going to work either. So here you have these a number of assets. Is there anything that's like what we're seeing right now is this disrupted building structure. Is there anything like some of the video games have environments you can walk into, like a castle? Do you have any of those kinds of kits where you're inside a 3D space and then you can modify it further? Because that would fit some of the project ideas for fashion that, as I can mention to some of the people here, if you're studio-driven and you have their projects and you want to build characters and all that, you're stuck in somebody else's idea. The big picture is I'm coming from another industry entirely that sees the potential of this applied. That's where the big the evolution of this is. I'm taking elements from another industry and saying I want to incorporate into these worlds immediately and see if this dynamic will work and turn into high-level sell-through for a number of fashion houses. And I said, well, here in my Unreal Engine, it works, there's no question. But I can't render it here. So do you have some of your kits that are like I mentioned, instead of buildings and structures from the outside where you're on the inside? You have any kits like that?
Sure, yeah, and super awesome question. And also thinking just in holistic terms about stepping outside of one industry and looking at how can other industries learn from the movies and games industry and use the tools. Fashion is one that is evolving in so many different ways. Danar, would you jump back over to just the kits within Cargo for just a second?
Of course.
What's your name, sir?
Alex.
Alex, cool. So Alex is working in fashion, and a couple things that we do is, so we have different types of kits. First, we have world kits, which are the exterior buildings that you'd use to make a skyline or the encompassing worlds. But what Alex is asking is, do we have interiors? And interiors are where is one of the new things that we brought to Cargo. We call them Cargo exclusives, and we're putting out a new one every month. And so this interior here is what you click on. Oh, you click on
police.
So the police station. So you can see we have the interior all the way. And actually, if you click on there, you can pop it open. So you can get all the way inside the environment that you're looking for. And we have these for many modern locations so far. So we have a lot of retail stores and luxury outlets and shopping places. And then within each of our worlds, if you go to Medieval Siege.
Medieval Siege.
Right there in the middle. So we were talking about castles. In the world itself, you can bring a camera all the way in. I wonder if we're going to be if we'd be able to download an asset right now.
Of course.
You can show him.
Let's see, we can download this one.
Go right into the middle of that fortress.
Yeah.
All right. And so then all of the pieces are built so that you can bring the camera as close to it as you want to, especially depending on what fidelity you need. But then we also service the props that can go along with it as well. So for things like castles, because they had a lot of locations that are courtyards and things that aren't necessarily an interior, we have a ton of things like that. We don't have an interiors kit of a castle specifically released yet, but there are lots of ways that you can use the kits to come into the scene, and you could put the focal point being a model in their new clothes, or you can use lots of runway shows are using these, and virtual production is also a really exciting way to connect what's happening on stage and using showcasing new products in new ways.
That's great. Okay.
Let's see.
So you can add the.
So let's see.
Colorize the interior and do the animation walkthrough, like you're walking in to this environment.
Definitely.
And you're observing, and then maybe you see something and you're curious about it. So I won't elaborate further, but this is where, for a lot of the users that are playing games, killing each other or doing other things in worlds where there are characters, this is highly interactive, not only for product development and sales, but education. I mean, it's multifaceted. But you're taking people into an environment where within that castle, they might be curious about the medieval timeline. And all of a sudden you have an educational aspect. And there's a lot of things that can go here, but I'd have to sit with a team and say, look, can you create this? Because it's viable.
Yeah.
And it's done, but it's done in ways where what people are buying into is, let's get another game and go kill everybody, you know, or let's do this or that. It's very narrow-minded, really. It's open-minded, but it's completely narrow.
Well, and Alex, I think I'm
anyway, glad, that's my opinion.
No, I'm sure I speak for everyone to say I'm really glad you've come to this, because you're exactly the type of use case that we're talking about, where the movies and games industry is obviously entertainment, and it is what is so exciting and appealing to so many people. But the applications of using these tools can go in so many different directions, as you're describing. I mean, I cannot wait for education, as you were just talking about. I cannot wait for the ways we can evolve the ways we're communicating using real time and 3D to tell that a new and unique story. And for all of you students in the room, you should probably have a conversation with Alex. And regardless of whether or not you want to work in an adjacent industry, probably be eye-opening for you at this stage of the game to just hear from someone else who is looking to hire talent with your skills and use it in other ways. And we talk about one for the real and one for the meal. I talked to a neurosurgeon the other day who's looking for an artist to help them build out a real life walkthrough of what having surgery would be like, and using it in real time and being able to go in and give patients before they go have surgery. And that's we talk about pragmatists, the deepest laggards in wanting to adopt new technology is the medical industry, but wanting to find, because it has to be so regulated and so safe, but even in industries like that, they're looking for disruption, and they're looking for new ways and better ways to utilize the skills that you're learning here. And so maybe for you, it has to be movies and video games. And the movies and video games businesses are not going anywhere. But the technology that you're learning and the skill sets that you're developing are applicable in so many other places, and that is going to accelerate in crazy ways. I mean, Alex talking about the trying to find new ways to pull people into a story and engage with his products or products that you're associated with is going to happen more and more and more and more. And this, you know, commercials is a great industry of, is a great like-to-like of how this happens. You know, so many of the great movie makers made their living over the last 15 years doing commercials, because the commercial, the brand, AT&T or Taco Bell wants to have the director of one of their favorite movies come to set and shoot it. And then you can go and make your movie adjacently to that. That now is one medium of just how video works. But now when we're able to take what real time is offering you and what interactivity is offering, and when that proliferates onto the internet, the opportunities are boundless. So be sure, before this is over, introduce yourself to Alex. Ask him a little bit about what he's interested in, and see if there's things you guys might be able to collaborate on. Thanks for the topic, Alex. Danar, yeah, please.
But by the way, it's usually the people outside our own industry that are thinking more creative about our job than the people in our industry, because it's usually the people in our industry that wants to keep us within the same structure and working. And this is why it's important to kind of go outside, because I always say, like, my worth in our own industry, I'm like a 7.5. That's how I look at it. But outside, I'm like a 30. You know what I mean? So it's also important to kind of like take a step back. You know, art is not this. Art is like this. We're in 3D, we're not in 2D anymore, right? So again, growing with art and figuring out what you want to do, that means also conversing with people you never thought you would be conversing with. And they may even come up with great ideas that you'd never thought about.
Can you talk a little bit about the crossover and out of industry types of projects that you've been working on recently?
Yeah, of course. I mean, so one of the things that I wanted to do is I wanted to kind of find my own voice within this industry. And I thought, you know, I've always been a super huge fan of hip hop, of rap, of ever since I was a kid. And I thought, like, you know, I want to find my own voice within this. So the first thing I did is kind of looking at like, all right, what is the like, what is the level right now? Is there any competition right now that is doing this? And there were like a couple of music videos that I saw that did that. And genuinely, I thought like I could do it better. And it's not that I could do it better, it's just I need to convince myself to do it better. So what did I do? I already worked on Last of Us and everything. I just took the time to email and message every person that I thought could do something for me. And that means like music video directors, this, that, like production designers. And in such a way that I knew that they're also nerds, so they like what I do, they just don't know I exist. And to be honest, guys, it's like, we're like the Wakandans. You know, like, we haven't come out yet. We're just practicing our airbending in the shadows, but nobody knows we exist. And I can guarantee you, every time I've showed my work to people, or other people's work, they were blown away that this job actually exists. So it's better time than ever right now for us to come outside and show that, you know, like you said in the beginning of your talk, we are the frontiers of the new generation of whatever building is like world building is going to happen, right? Ready Player One is going to become a reality, and it's you guys that are going to be hired and build that world. You, not the people that put the money in it, whatever. Obviously, we need investment, but it's your ideas and your creativity that's going to lead this. And when you're conscious of that and you truly see yourself, for lack of better terms, not as a soldier but as a leader, then your opportunity is just going to be endless.
Really cool points. And I think there's so much to glean from that. One of the things I think is so important that you talked about is just the importance of putting yourself out there. And I think it's easy to be in a vacuum and look at people to the left and right of you who are doing amazing things. But with the internet, with the ability to go on to LinkedIn or email the person that you'd like to know about your work, gives you a really unique opportunity to connect with people and to find new opportunities. Because as Danar was saying, there's a local famousness to what is going on here and the way digital art works. But outside of this immediate industry, there's not a ton of knowledge around what's happening here. And especially as things are advancing so quickly, there are a ton of people who didn't go to SIGGRAPH, but had they would be in the same position that Alex is in, where they're working in some business, where they're looking for something that you have that they didn't even know they needed. Or that finding someone who has these types of skills is even available or interested in coming in and talking about how do you disrupt some of the pieces of the puzzle that they're doing. So lots and lots of opportunity for you to use tools available and connect in different ways. All right, so Danar, catch us up on yeah. Where you are.
So right now what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to find the texture and sculpt on top of it. And the way we do that is, let's see, dust noise texture. So basically what the cool thing about this is, let's see, displacement, right. So let's say, you know, we're gonna use actually trying to find the correct texture. Well, we can make a new one.
Walk us through the thought process.
Right. So the thought process is we have a flat plane now, right? And let's say we want to have some broken floors or broken grounds, and how do we do that? There's different ways of doing that. Obviously, you can use the displacement that we already have a texture with from KitBash, which is damaged a normal. No, I think, oh yeah, here. Damaged a height, we can use this. This is the name. All right, because I just want to show you guys what I mean with that. So let's say on the floor, you know, we're going to do a couple of bricks. Sculpt. That's cool. So the cool thing about this is like, it's a brick, right? Doesn't matter. We're going to make our own kind of design out of it. Look at that. Didn't make sense, right? It's just bricks. Doesn't matter. Because what's the number one rule in art? Form language, right? Shapes. Find the shapes. And that's what we're doing right now. All right. Now, what we got is see that? All right. That works better. Why not? And genuinely, like, the thing about concept art, after 10 years, I figured out you never know what the end result is. Just kind of after a while, you have an experience of, hey, if I do this, you know, it's math. Mm-hmm. 1 + 1 = 2. 2 + 2 = 4. And after a while, your math equations just become super high. And you just have to find the answer. But you figured out it. 1 + 1 = 2. So again, the more often you do it, the more you don't even think about it. Your brain just knows, like, hey, do this. Hey, when this happened, do that. And when you kind of evolved from a junior to a senior is when you found your own process, generally. I think that's when you will notice the evolvement because you're not focusing on it anymore. It just goes natural. So one thing that I did to get to that certain point where I can, you know, naturally or find my process is what I did last year is I challenged myself to take multiple jobs at the same time, but not lacking the quality. And what that means is like, all right, figuring out, you know, what holds me back as an artist. And most of the time is when we talk about is like, you know, when you're painting and they always say don't zoom in too early, right? Or you go too much into detail. And the idea right now is exactly the same thing. It's like figuring out how to start from the big blocks, you know, the shape, big shapes, and then you cut it off to like the medium shapes and then the details. It's the same thing in the progress. Once you figure that out, as in like, how do I start? How do I come to a certain point where it's enough to show the client, because 95% of the time the client doesn't know what he's looking at, and how do I finish this up? When you found this process, it's actually not the doing that's gonna be tough, it's only the ideas after that, because you found a process. All right, what did I do now? I made a background, I figured out when I made a flat plane in the background, I put it on emission, it's gonna relight from the backside and it looks like it's a sky. Cool, I figured that out, I'm gonna use that often. All right, second stage, how do I build the environment? Let's say you don't have any ideas. You treat it like a film scouting. What do films do before they actually go film? They scout areas, right? Well, right now I'm scouting the ground. I'm looking if I like it this way or I like it that way. I'm not sure yet, but I'm making something that I think is within this realm. And then eventually when you're working on this, it's like relying on your expertise that the idea will come. And we go back to self-confidence and how do you get this, right? How do you achieve this? And you said that in the beginning is not being comfortable, is going towards the challenge. And if that challenge is AI, if that challenge is 3D, if that challenge is this or that, or something you don't like, then you should definitely go into it, because trust me, at the end of it, you'll meet a new person that you didn't know you can become. And that's the beauty about art. That's one thing we have that nobody else has, is we can actually like gracefully age, because we're always nurturing our youthfulness, you know what I mean? Whereas other people, they try to grow up really fast. For us, it's not the case. And this is why we are, you know, entertainers of life, and you have to see yourself as that. I want you guys to not think like, I wanna work for George Lucas, I want you to think like, I wanna do better than George Lucas. Because that's the attitude right now. If George Lucas was 24 right now, what would he have done? He would have bought cargo and start making his Star Wars project. and bring it to life. You just didn't have the tools at that time.
I think often about that for so many of the great creators of the last of decades past, and what would they would be doing with some of these tools now. And I think it would blow their minds what you're able to achieve.
It is beautiful, because, and it's super scary, because nobody promised us that, you know, this is how it's going to end up like. But nobody knew that streamers are gonna be the new famous people. And it still happened. Mm-hmm. It's just a shift in life. I truly believe life is art, right? Because it's constantly changing.
It's interesting hearing you talk about relying on your discipline, right? Yeah. Relying on the skill. You said the expertise, and what I interpret that is the time in, you know, the background that you have of doing this day in and day out. It's fascinating watching you have a conversation while making creative decisions along the way, and it's unique. To hear you just describe that you're discovering it, you know, and to watch you let the image reveal itself to you along the way.
Yeah, it's like for me going on a date. I kind of know what the direction is. I kind of know what I like, but I'm still open to learn, if that makes sense.
Dating your art.
Dating my art, exactly. And I think I said this last year at our Q&A, we had this Q&A, and I was talking about the fact that art is like, you know, you have to treat it like you're in a relationship with that person. Being too often in front of your screen is like the same as being often with your girlfriend or boyfriend or whatever. And you need break from each other, because you're gonna get annoyed by the smallest things. And that's the detailing. You know what I mean? Bigger picture. Take a step back. And again, like the rules in life, that's the beauty. You guys already figured out the rules in life. Most people don't figure that out their whole life. You guys did by doing art. And you've learned the basic rules that you can apply to anything. And I genuinely believe that we are like, you know, there's this quote that they say, the creatives are the new athletes. Mm. I genuinely think we are. It's just, it's important that we also behave with that attitude and believe in that. You know, you don't need other people to tell you who you are. You have to know it first. You have to believe in your own bullshit first.
Well, and speaking of challenge and being an athlete, and relying on your discipline and discovering something, we've got 10 minutes left, and I just got the signal. We got 10 minutes to nail this. I was thinking it'd be fun to see you dive in here and as quickly as you can uncover something in 10 minutes.
Oh, okay. Okay.
as Danar's teeing that up, he's got 10 minutes that he's gonna piece together and get to an image. Any other questions here? Things that you all wanna make sure we cover? You've been a terrific audience. Yeah, please.
Hi. I was just curious, with how many like models and kits there are in general, like how many like artists do you have to create all these? Or do you do like freelance, like people like all over the world, or is there like a brick and mortar place, something like that?
Great question. So we have evolved our pipeline over the years. And so every year we have made a free update to Cargo and or to KitBash and the full KitBash library. So when we launched our kits in 2017, didn't have textures. And then the next year we brought textures. And then in year three, we brought native files to the traditional DCCs, 3ds Max, Maya, Blender, Cinema. And then in our 4.0 update, we brought real-time. 5.0, we were really developing Cargo, and we updated several quality of life pieces. And then we called Cargo our 6.0 update, because Cargo Basic is free. If you have a kit that you purchased in the past or that you purchased today, you can use that kit in Cargo. I know I'm taking a long-winded way to your question, but I think it's important to just talk about the evolution, because using Cargo Basic today, you can, which we consider to be our 6.0 update, allows you to get in and use Cargo there. And then Cargo Pro opens you up to the entire library. In that same iterative process, we have evolved our pipeline in the way we've built kits. Today we have a very large team. We have over 30 artists that work in-house, and everything we do at KitBash is entirely built in-house, because it's important to us first that we make a product that we stand behind, and that we make a product that fits with the ethos of what we're trying to do, which is make assets that just work for you in so many different ways. And it's very important that along the way, we can do an update to the entire library. And dealing with a library of more than 10,000 assets, updating that frequently is a rather large task. So it's very important that we can control the process of it along the way. And then that the pipeline has developed to where rather than, as you were asking, do we have freelancers, it's a full team will then work on an individual kit. And they work actually in conjunction, the concept artists, the texture artists, and the modelers. And we have different strike teams that will work together along the way to make the next ones. Thank you for that question. Please.
Hi, this is my last question, I swear. So I've never been afraid of AI. I feel like it's part of our generation to change and adjust. So my question would be, as a person that wants to go into characters and rigging, have you guys ever thought about adding some kind of library or AI library that generates characters, including the rig or something like that, to your program?
It's a great question. You know, these tools and pipelines are rapidly evolving, and there's a number of different things that we have on our roadmap that we're doing in the immediate term. And then, like we talked about, there's no crystal ball on where so much of this goes. For us, it's always the question of what would enable and inspire creators the most, and what, given the resources and time that we have, what can we do to quickly, as quickly as possible, bring it to the next level. And you know, we have no shortage of really amazing things that we would love to do, and many of them that we plan to do, and then it becomes just a prioritization. But it's a really great point. There is so much opportunity for new ways of doing things and improving the process. Yeah. All right, Danar, talk to us about, give us a little.
So you guys noticed that I changed the camera angle, right? And again, like I said, this is why it's very important, you know, where the idea of you guys practicing art, practicing composition, lighting, drawing, whatever, is because you're just learning to solve the issue every time you just don't get it. Like, I just noticed the camera looked too flat and doesn't convey the idea that I wanted to convey. I have some depth, you know, and breaking it off in like water, ground, buildings, sky, so everything is readable, right? So I just switched the camera a bit, and all of a sudden the storytelling changed as well. So forever evolving until it's done. And when it's done, we'll know that at the end. We'll figure that out. But until that point, it's just constantly trying to figure out. And one great rule, everybody stick to this, and this is one lesson that I really taught myself, is when there are probably moments everybody had this, like it's like 10 p.m. at night, and you just can't figure out this issue, trust yourself that taking a, like, you're gonna sleep, and tomorrow morning you'll know. That's the attitude. Because if you believe that you won't know, then you probably won't. There's two types of people on this planet. One who believe they can, and one who believe they can't. And they're both right. And you just have to decide on which side you are at.
It's such a, so many valuable pieces there. And one I think, the idea of taking a step back, especially when you're in the problem, you know, and you're deeply in the problem, you're trying to jam your way through it, especially on a deadline. Sometimes taking a pause, taking a walk, taking a break, taking a shower. There's an idea that your best ideas come in the shower when you're most relaxed. And it's oftentimes that we try and squeeze so much out of what we're doing that we can get lost in the process and lose the plot of it. No. But in those moments, as Danar was talking about, if you can take a step back and with confidence know that you'll find it, wake up tomorrow morning and all of a sudden the answer's there.
Yeah, no, so this process, what I'm showing you right now, right? We had enough time to have this great start to give you an idea of what this potentially could mean for you guys, and well, it's exactly at time, it just crashed. But what we could do is, I want to show you guys two things that I started using. So,
oh, please.
First of all, because of the great guys at KitBash, I got to meet a very important person who is a friend right now, and she happens to be Kid Cudi's manager. First logic, when I met her is, I can do concept art, cool, but what then? What does that mean for me, right? So the moment I met her, I thought, and I told her, you know I'm gonna meet Kid Cudi, right? But I know I have to prove you, because that's how we are as humans. So what did I do? I took, and this was all like, universe was talking. Cargo just came out a month. I was working indirectly with Karina, and I thought, hey, let me come up with an idea. Use Cargo, fast ideas, and then pitch an idea to Kid Cudi and to Karina and see if they like it. That was her name, sorry. So, you know, I made this, it took me 2-3 weeks, and at the end of it, I can tell you, I didn't want to send it, I wanted to delete it, because I thought this is shit. Excuse my language.
Here we are. Here we go.
So, what the important thing about this is, the way I'm explaining it is, all right, we had animation films from animators, we have had films from graphic designers, we have had blah, blah, blah from this side, but we have never had the concept art version of this. And what I mean with that is, like, it's time for us to be concept creators and not concept art. Art is 2D. You have to... As soon as you figure out that what you're making, the art that you're making in 3D, is just one frame of the full, complete film, and if that one frame works, like this right here is one scene, if this scene works, then I know I have like 1,000 camera shots that I can use and reuse from different corners, right? And this is the beauty about Cargo and about kit bashing is it's about the idea. Is anybody wondering, hey, what kind of kit is that in the back? Did Danar built a kit that nobody cares, right? It's about the full story here. And this is the beauty about it. It's now, and this is the most fearful time. This is the most scary time for young artists, but also like the most exciting times. Is you can do whatever you want. It's just the question is, who are you and what do you want? And this is something that we are still figuring out, you know? If I ask Banks, what are you going to do in 10 years? He doesn't know, but he knows the direction he's going to take. And he trusts on himself that he'll know at the right time to go to a certain area that he is craving for. That makes sense. And, you know, again, this is art. So we don't know what the end result could be. All you can hope for is just go that path which makes you happy.
Well, it is incredible to watch you on the path and to watch how quickly you're able to spin up so many different ideas and obviously built on deep experience in this, but also watching you play and watching you explore and have fun with the process.
Thank you for having me. And, you know, again, this is just a small thing that we could actually show on Cargo, but I can guarantee you, once you start playing around with this, it's just the ideas will come pouring in, and all of a sudden, it's not hard to draw a castle, but it's harder to come up with a unique idea with that castle, and that's more fun.
So to that point, Cargo Basic, you can go get on kitbash3d.com right now. It's free to download. There are a lot of free assets there that you can immediately start playing with. And explore and get to see more of what Danar is talking about. We also have a special gift from Noman to the Noman students. There will be several classes that will be using Cargo going forward, and all of the Noman students will get a special discount from Noman on Cargo, Cargo Pro going forward. So very excited about seeing all of the amazing things that this community will be able to do with this, and excited to see the projects and hear the feedback and get to partner with you all in so many exciting ways. Thank you all tremendously for being part of this. As right before we pass it over to Chris, just the picture we've painted here in so many ways is one of boundless possibility for you if you are willing to take it. And if you are willing to believe in this and go for it and work with other people and show up day in and day out with, despite how it is that you're feeling about it, but put your courageous self out there and explore new possibilities, the world is absolutely here to explore the new and exciting virtual frontier with you. So thank you all so much for being here with us. You've been a terrific audience. Thank you for listening to us and participating. And throw it back over to Chris.
Thank you all so much. That was inspirational and informative. I mean, that was great. I hope you all enjoyed it. I hope you all enjoyed it here. You're welcome to stay a little bit longer. But for you at home, make sure that you stay up to date with us on all of our socials. And if you have any questions on what Noman can do for you, go ahead and send us an email at info@noman.edu. And until then, we'll see you next time. Bye. See you all. Yeah, bye.